Hello, and welcome to what will be Battle Report 7 for my channel. If you are one of the three or four people who follow my channel, you would probably notice that it's been a very long time since I put up a battle report. This is due to some obvious changes in the scene. Not a lot of fantasy being played around here. Not that there was beforehand, but now it's gone. This will be my first Kings of War battle report. So, getting into that, and it's been lots of fun, and I'll talk about it after this. So, this is a 2,000 point battle report. We will play Kingdoms of Men, which I will be playing, versus Undead. You can see the Kingdoms of Men list here. It is somewhat formatted to make it quick to read, but essentially I've been playing with trying to work out a setup where I could have two pike hordes and support for them. So the main focus of this army setup is two pike hordes and lots of fast, hard-hitting stuff on the flanks. This is working out pretty good. So you can see it here. Otherwise, just three sources of inspiring and a couple of other things, and I'll talk about it all afterwards. The undead opponent, my wife. I made this list for her under the idea that it would be a elite zombie setup. So, zombie legion, a zombie horde, and zombie trolls. And then very little chaff, but lots of really elite characters, as you can see in the bottom. Morgoth, Vampire Lord, and a Necromancer. So, Necromancer is not that elite, but the other two are very expensive and very quite capable troops. So we'll go into setup. Sorry for a couple of the blurry pictures here. This is the Undead's right flank. Undead center. And Undead left. Those Wild Riders are the Soul Reaver Cavalry. We're getting some. They were just on pre-order in Manticus. Supposedly shipping, we just haven't seen them yet. So Kingdoms of Men, as also you will notice, a lot of my stuff is unpainted. I have several painted armies, but with Kings of War 2, I really like the Kingdom of Men list, so I had to buy a bunch of new miniatures, and I'm working on them. There'll be some painted stuff, but not very much. So you can see on my left flank, we have a troop of arquebusiers, a regiment of mounted sergeants, a pike horde. This is the Pathfinder one, so you can walk through the woods, and there's a wizard behind them. My center, pike horde, artillery, wizard, berserkers, and then general on a winged beast. And on my right flank is the two troops of scouts, a flagger on a horse with the healing charm, and a regiment of knights. So, to hop right in it, turn one, Kingdom of Men, take the first turn. My opponent won the roll-off to pick who goes first, and I told her, yeah, you should probably take second turn. There's no benefit for her going first. The scenario was pillage, and the tokens were majoritively on my opponent's side. So my opponent didn't need to go very far and didn't really benefit from first turn because there wasn't much to do. So, as you can see, all of my units on my left flank move up. The units in my right move up. The winged general is a little more cautious. And on the right, my units move up. I'm basically trying to bait those Soul Reaver cavalry or that flying vampire up top there. I'm really outclassed on the right flank, so I'm mostly trying to get a bait of her to kill off one of my units of scouts and hope that a knight block coming in with the Brew of Strength would do a number to one or two of those units. So that's like that. We go into shooting, and a few damage is done onto one of the skeleton archer units here, but I rolled double ones. A little bit of lightning bolt onto the zombie trolls. And for some reason, this is here. Go to undead turn one. Undead turn one, the flying. That Geisha lady is a vampire lord flying with the wings of honeybees. The vampire lord flies back over to help heal up the skeleton archers. They were a little bit of damaged, and there's not a lot of other elements of her army there to hold that token, so she's going back to heal them. Otherwise, you can see her two zombie blocks move up cautiously. Not to give me the charge, just enough to move up and get in the way. the same with the zombie trolls and the Morgor back there. He moved up a little bit, and the necromancer behind the zombies moves up. Shooting, just a few damage here. Arquebusers. The catapult landed its shot on the mounted sergeants and did 3 damage. The vampire healed the skeleton archers. Sorry for the blurry picture, but the necromancer healed those guys, the trolls. Turn two. I advance wholeheartedly. I know that these pikes are going to take the charge, but I have to confront where she's sitting because essentially those zombie hordes are basically going to sit on top of those tokens. So I'm going to have to take some charges, but in my experience, pike blocks have done pretty good at taking charges. But I've not fought an army like this before with them. A little bit more in the center. Everyone's just moving up. The unit above the trolls there are the wraiths in her list. I should have gone over those better, but they're the wraiths. I'm letting her have a charge with those wraiths on either of the berserkers or the winged beasts. Wraiths are flying, so they can come on in. I'm just accepting that as a fact. I move my scouts here, left one there, up to chaff those Soul Reaver cavalry even more. I don't have any reason to charge them. I'm not any better in combat than I am just shooting. So I just get up to an inch away and sit in their face. And shooting, I shoot up these archers a little bit more. My artillery, which hits once the entire game, hit the zombie trolls and was wounding on, I think it was twos, and just throwing my failure here of, wow, thanks guys. somebody else shooting at these guys, I'm guessing the arquebusiers, probably. And I get a lightning off on these guys. So the skeletons on her right flank, the skeleton archers, routed, which was cool. Undead turn two starts with charges. So the legion of zombies charges into my pike block on the bottom. The horde of zombies and horde of trolls double charge the other pike block. The wraiths come swooping in to the berserkers. And the Soul Reaver cavalry goes into my chaff because they gotta get out of the way somehow. this is a bit of a mistake. We get she puts a bane chant on these guys, but doesn't realize that they're already crushing strength 2 until she looked it up. So we end up putting bane chant on the zombies next to him. And getting a bane chant off on the big legion of zombies. So that's not good. But just some shooting, a couple damage here. Her catapult hits again and puts 3 damage on my general. And as you would expect, in combat, the Soul Reaver cavalry easily wipe out the scouts. The wraiths put 4 damage on my berserkers. And the double charge of zombies and zombie trolls puts 12 damage on my pike block. And the legion of zombies gets 9 damage on this pike block, which was quite surprising. I guess I'm a little bit more used to putting pike blocks at something a little more elite, where their ensnare is somewhat more helpful. So they sit there. Turn 3. Turn 3, Kingdom of Men. The knights happily charge the Soul Reaver Cavalry. again, a little outclassed, but the Soul Reaver Cavalry have a reasonably low Weaver en route, or nerve. So, some hope. The Mounted Sergeants and the Pike Block double charge the Legion of Zombies. The lower Pike Block charges the Horde of Zombie Trolls. And the Berserkers charge the Wraiths. The Mounted Sergeant, or Mounted General, charges the Skeleton Archers. Into shooting, the Flagger with the Healing Charm heals all the damage off these guys. Showing we get Bane Chant on the Pike Block, and we get a Bane Chant on the Berserkers. After combat, these knights actually do a respectable 7 damage to the Soul Reaver Cavalry. The knights are Thunderous Charge 2, and they have the Brew of Strength. So, you know, that helps. And luckily enough, they end up wavering them. 7 damage plus 8 is 15, so it was a lucky roll. So, I'll take it. The Berserkers come in and do a... yeah, Berserkers, lots of attacks, hitting on 3s, Bane Chanted, do a whopping 1 damage to the Wraiths. But the Wraiths are out of Inspiring, and I roll an 11. So 11 makes 12, and they're gone, which was incredibly lucky, and I'm very happy with that. My Pikemen do some reasonable amount of damage here. My combined Pike Block and Mounted Sergeants only does 13 damage here, and with a with her army has Morgoth the Faceless, and Morgoth the Faceless gives one unit besides himself the regeneration 5 plus rule. She's given that regeneration 5 plus rule to the Legion of Zombies. So I will show this next turn, but it is 13 damage is not enough. My general routes these guys no problem and reforms. So on to undead turn 3. Her flying vampire comes into the rescue. This was not really a rules discussion point, but it was just realized she's less than an inch wide on her base and she flies. So there wasn't any reason I couldn't see why she couldn't charge the knights. She could see them. And she could fly in there and land. So, I don't know if anybody has any ideas on why she could or shouldn't do this. Let me know. I honestly recommended that she do it. It's a way to possibly save her Soul Reaver Cavalry. Otherwise, they're not going to make it anywhere. Movement. So here's where regen starts to get to be a problem. So she gets 5 damage back. So that's pretty big. Just sitting there. You roll 13 dice in this case, and on every 5 up, you get a damage back. So, unless you can knock those guys out, you're, like, in a turn, they're going to start getting it back. Throwing some healing on the zombie trolls. We go into combat. The vampire lord does 5 damage to my knights, and unfortunately wavers them. Which is a big bummer, because 5 damage is, you know, it's respectable. But, ugh. Now they're going to sit there, and that's not helpful. The zombies and zombie trolls hit these guys again, knocking their damage up to 17 and routing them, as you can see, and reforming as such. The zombie trolls have turned around, because they're about to take a winged beast general. And would rather take it in the front. The zombie legion attacks and routes my other pike block. And reforms as such. So that's a bummer. But what can you do? So we go into turn 4. Men turn 4. Throwing caution to the wind, we just throw the mounted sergeants back in, just maybe hoping to waver those zombies. That zombie legion is not going to be killed by a unit of mounted sergeants, but they've got really nothing else to do, so why not? The winged beast general comes flying into those trolls. The winged beast general has the beast slang or something like that. It gives them a +2 crushing strength against large infantry, large cavalry, monsters, hero monsters, and things like that. So he's going to be swinging crushing strength 4 at those guys, so it's pretty good matchup. My horsemen just zoom up here, and my knights, they're wavered. We get a lightning bolt off, and do a few damage to this here necromancer, which is cool. My beast general comes in and does pretty good, but I roll really well, and so we end up getting a 19 total, and that routes those guys. Again, see my mounted sergeants come in, and they get some more damage back on, but with like a 28 or something nerve, you're not going to do that. I'd have to have rolled boxcars twice, and didn't happen. So they bounce back. So we go into undead turn 4, and the zombie legions. Well, the zombie legion goes into my mounted sergeants, and the zombie horde goes into my wizard, who's hanging out. Which I think I actually put that wizard there so they couldn't flank my sergeants, but it's not a big deal. And the Soul Reaver cavalry back to life come into my knights, and that's just not good. Flying angry vampire lady comes flying over here. Shooting, the Balefire catapult hits again and boxes this guy up to 6. Looks like we're just showing some regen. So, yeah, they got 5 more regen back. So, as you'd expect, the Soul Reaver Cavalry kill out my knights pretty good. And that's that. The Legion of Zombies routs out my Mounted Sergeants. No problemo. The Horde of Zombies only puts 2 damage on my wizard. And he says, fine, he makes it out okay. So, that was actually kind of surprising. So men turn 5, I didn't take a picture of a dice, but here we go. Men turn 5, the flying general comes flying into the back of the zombies horde. The berserkers go into the flank. My flagger with the healing charm comes flying over here to shoot some heals at people, because he's got nothing else to do. And we are able to, well, you know, those berserkers in the flank are like 30 attacks, but anyway, we're obviously able to rout these zombies. We do a little reforming to face around. And for some reason I have this. This isn't men. This is undead. This is undead turn 5. Just ignore that little tank. It's right in the next one. In turn 5, Morgor the Faceless goes up. He's going to move. I'll show it in the next sign. Otherwise, this... One of the necromancer comes down here. Morgor the Faceless comes up here so he can breath attack my berserkers because they are pretty squishy. The flying vampire flies as a vampire into these guys and is going to smash them good. The Soul Reaver cavalry go down to take their token. The Balefire catapult hits again, but she doesn't roll very good, so my guy's okay. Unfortunately, yeah, I forgot to put a route thing in this. The Morgor the Breathless does his breath weapon and gets 8 damage, up to 8 damage on the berserkers, and then she rolls a 10 twice. So they're routed. As you could expect, the angry vampire routes the already damaged scouts. No problemo. We go into turn 6. Turns are getting pretty fast at this point. There's not a lot left on the table. Men, I just move a few things around. I move my general up enough so he's out of range of the flying vampire, but he's still within 3 inches of the token. So that token I can claim as long as she isn't able to shoot him out. Because it's turn 6, so she's not going to move her zombies that are standing there by the other token to take him. So He's really wounded, but he's hanging out. He's the best he can do. I start flying up my wizards. As you can see in this picture, the only thing claiming the top left token there is that catapult. So the one wizard moves up, but can't quite get in the way to see him. The reason I'm doing this is if there is a turn 7, I can hopefully get both wizards up there to shoot some lightning bolts at him. An uninspired war machine with the 10-12 isn't that tough. So, undead, crazy vampire lady comes smashing into my flagger for nothing else to do. Morgor comes to breathe a little breath on my flying general and knocks him out, no problem. Vampire lady, though, does a really bad nerve roll. And so my flagger lives for, whatever comedy that entails. We roll it off, and we get a turn 7. So, as you can see here, both of my wizards are flying up and around. So here's another picture of that. She has put her inspiring necromancer up and next to her catapult. But I can see it with both wizards. So, both wizards take their shots. I get 3 damage on the lightning bolt, or on the catapult. And the only hope this has is if I can kill this catapult, I tie. If I can't kill this catapult, I lose. And I roll a 3. Catapult is fine. So that's the end of the game. She had 3 tokens, and I only had 2. So overview of the board. See there, the catapult has 1. Her horde, or her legion of zombies has 1. And her Soul Reaver Cavalry way at the top have the other 1. The other half of the board here that you haven't seen very much, my arquebusiers have 1, and my siege artillery has 1. So, oh, there they are, holding their token. So, surprisingly, 2 unclaimed tokens, but it was a pretty bloody battle, so I can see how that happens. So in the end, like I said, it was a victory to the undead. The undead held 3 tokens, while I held 2. Those of you who are unfamiliar with Kings of War, the pillage scenario takes no account of kills. Killing units gains you, a tactical advantage, but it doesn't help you win the game. The only way to win is to hold those pieces. So, that was a victory on her part. There is a scenario in the Kings of War book that is pillage and kill, which would combine those things, but this isn't the one we rolled up. So, kudos to my opponent. She had a good time, and I think that's what it's really all about. Some general thoughts on this particular battle. I have been playing these Pike Hordes for a little while against Forces of Nature opponent a lot, and he happens to use big salamander hordes. Now, these heavy pike blocks are perfect counter to that. They are they really outclass those salamander hordes. Now, I think these pike blocks might be a little better against a more elite opponent. That ensnare is particularly nasty when you have less attacks. I know this all adds up in the end, but a horde of legion of zombies with 40 attacks and the brew of sharpness, yeah, they're still hitting on 5s, but that's a lot of hits. And a bane chant changes that really quick. So it was just a lot of damage coming at me that I couldn't really respond to appropriately. So I think maybe I should have put my pikes on the flanks. Like, I think a pike brick up against those Soul Reaver cavalry probably actually would have done pretty decent. Like, that would have been a much more better matchup in my favor, as opposed to trying to push my pikes together with a mage support. Otherwise, I do not really care that much for the artillery for my humans in this game. I've had several games with dwarves and cannons and things like that where I'll have 7 turns and you get 0 hits. It's just, it hits on a 5-up, sometimes on a 6-up, depending on the scenario. I think the points should just be better used in more chaff. Which comes to my last point. I really like the mounted scouts. Movement 9, nimble, 100 points. They're a great speed bump to throw out, and if you can get them around the enemy, you know, they might only hit on fives, but if you hit a war machine, that's 15 attacks hitting on fives. That's 5 hits. You know, it's not great, but for a cheap little thing. So I have some more Fireforge Mongols to put together. I just haven't got around to it yet. I really like that kit, and I should probably show some of those off someday because it's a great kit, but holy crap, everything is in a piece, like an arm, a head, a body, well, a torso, legs. Like it's fine. It's just like it's way too many pieces. So anyway, I've rattled on here long enough. I hope you enjoyed the battle report. More Kings of War battle reports will be coming in the future, and very unlikely any more fantasy. So let's look forward to that, and thanks for watching, guys. Bye.